Well, hope you're doing well. I just want to run you through what I've been up to for the last couple of days, because I reckon that this might be handy to someone in the future. It was a weird problem, and it popped up when I was down near Sydney a couple of weeks ago. I took the car for a 2,500 kilometre road trip, and as I reached Sydney, a weird thing happened. So I turned the car off. I have no oil pressure problems in this car whatsoever. And I turned the car off in the afternoon, came back to it the next day, started it up, and I had half the oil pressure I had the day before. And I said, oh gee, that's a bit weird. Screwed around with it for a bit. So the first thing I did was I pulled what I thought was the oil pressure relief valve, which is this one here. And that was clear and functioning properly. It turns out that's not actually the oil pressure relief valve. It's a balance valve that goes between the two chambers in and out of the oil filter. It's been an absolute ordeal in getting to the actual oil pressure relief valve, which is underneath the oil filter here. It's on in line on the little tube. Let's see if I can get the torch here. That little tube which returns down into the sump, it's on that tube there that you'll find that relief valve, and I have it right here. So this is the oil pressure relief valve on a Jag 420. I believe this is the same for early XJ6s as well. And so basically the symptoms that I had were start the car, it'd go to 45 PSI when it's cold, and then fairly quickly as the car would heat up, it would come back to near zero. Which is bloody worrying, isn't it? The first thing I thought was maybe it would be the oil pressure sender, which was going out, which is located just on top of the housing here. This has got a manual gauge and fitting in there at the moment. To test that, what I did was I took the wire which goes up to your electric gauge in the dash, just sent that to ground. That will check the gauge itself is functioning, and what it does when it goes to ground, it will go to the maximum reading it can provide, which is what, 60 psi in this car, and it did that no issues, so we can rule that out. The next one, everyone online said, oh mate, your sender will be fucked. So what I did to confirm that was I got a manual gauge, manual oil pressure gauge, just fitted that to where the sender would be taking off the block, and sure enough it is true. So the sender, however old it is still working working fine. A little bit concerning, because I yellowed it when I was down in Sydney. I thought, okay, the absolute worst that this could be is that I've fucked all the main bearings in the engine. It sounded and still sounds great. I mean, this engine, there's nothing wrong with it. And I thought, oh, look, at the very worst, I can replace all the main bearings and that will be cheaper than a tow back to Brisbane. So I yolloed it all the way back here. It would be operating at about 20 PSI the whole way back. So the reason I thought straight away oil pressure relief valve is because the moment you give it revs, it comes straight up. But then the moment you back off, it goes to zero or close to zero, two or three. So, I mean, that's classic oil pressure relief valve symptoms. And that's why I was scratching my head when I pulled this, which is what I thought it was. This is fine. And then I got back to Brisbane and I started playing around with it a little bit more and realized, hang on, no, it's actually in that little transfer pipe back into the sump. I just want to show you what an absolute fucking mission it was to get that off. As they say, it's one 2-hour job is only a broken bolt away from being a 10-day ordeal. I didn't break the bolt. So the bolt for this one here, you can tell someone's had a go at it before. All four of these new bolts, this one here was the original. I mean, they're all original, but this one here was very dirty. It hadn't been touched in a long time. And I'll show you what I had to do to get it out. So that power steering pump, the actual front cover for that, which is plumbed into your power steering pump up here, was in the way of getting to the bolt down here. So I was screwing around, I thought, oh okay, well look, I'll just pull the pump out. Well, that's not an easy thing to do either. So on the steering arm underneath that pump, let's see if I can go under to show you. So this is what I'm dealing with. This is on the other side of the power steering pump there. So I thought, okay, I'll just pull this arm off, and then that's what the book says to do: pull the arm off, and then remove the pump from below. Well, both of these joints here are pressure fit. I'd say they're probably tapered. They're pressure fit onto their bolts there, and I can't get. I've got a flywheel puller, and I can't get that flywheel puller behind on enough of this on the lever to get some purchase on it, and I can't get it off, can't pry it off. So then I was scratching my head thinking, okay, what the hell else do I do? Okay, so if I come back up here. So I didn't really want to touch this pump because it's however old and it didn't leak. And I thought, okay, the moment I touch it, it'll start leaking like a fucking sieve. We're yet to see if that happens. So what I had to do is actually pull the cover off that. You can see where all the high and low pressure line is there. Where it plumbs into the actual pump itself, or I don't know. I guess the pump is up here and this would be the actuator or something. I don't know. Never screwed around with power steering before. I pulled that off and then I got some purchase on that bolt and I was able to get it off. And I think I actually saved a little bit of grit. I was expecting to find something quite large holding that valve open, but what I found instead, let's see if I can find it. Where are you? Where are you? This tiny little piece of plastic. This is what I found in there. There might have been something else in there that washed out with the oil when I drained it, but this here was definitely holding that valve open. And I've read online that it does not take much at all to kill your oil pressure. And that thing was stuck fast in there. So I thought, oh, look, it's probably not that. Maybe it is something more serious. And I'd have to go towards pulling the sump off and playing around with oil filters and whatever not. I'm confident, reasonably confident, that this is what will have done it. So I guess what I'll do is I'll put the thing back together now, and see how we go. Oh, by the way, I was thinking, oh, where the fuck did that come from? A little piece of hard plastic. It looks like it's come. Oh, I don't know. I really don't know. Look, it could be something rubber that's so old that it feels quite hard and it has a bit of give to it. I don't know. I don't know. But if I show you the actual relief valve itself, I was expecting a little ball to drop out of there. But what it is, so this end here, it's on your oil pump side. This here is on the outlet side of the filter block here. And there was a little bit of crap caught. So this side here is what seals up to the filter housing. And it was caught on that lip there. And from what I read online, it does not take much. There's actually two guys I was reading about with their 420s. Also applicable for XJ6, by the way. They were saying, even though the damage on this was so small, it was a different story, they damaged this. But the damage was so small that they had to take it off with a lathe. And that was still enough to cause exactly the same symptoms that I've got here. Probably the bigger question that I'll have next is, did I fuck the rest of the motor? It wouldn't be irreparably so, but did I fuck the rest of it by driving it 1,000 kilometers with 20 PSI of oil pressure? The first thing I did actually, because I've just set all the valves in here, and I thought, oh look, maybe there's a chance that one of the main bearing caps has come off. Silly idea that, but I thought, okay, I'll check. Pull these covers off, and there's still plenty of oil in there. The first thing I did was, I was very, very worried, but oh, we're not going to get that off. But what I was doing is I was actually looking in here. You can see the camshaft, and you can see this bearing, and there's still enough oil coming through that bearing that I was satisfied that it wasn't going to. I was satisfied it was still getting flow. So even though the pressure gauge is reading fuck all, I mean, there's still enough to lube the top end. And I'm holding it, 2 or 3,000 RPM on the highway. I think that probably the worst thing to do would be to keep it idling, and I didn't do that. At the very worst, I guess it could be bottom end rebuild time, but that doesn't. I'm not too nervous about that. I mean, a set of bearing shells is what, $60, and might take me a couple of days to get it done. Also, I said in previous videos I was having issues. It's been a while since I've done a video, but I said in previous videos that I was still having a problem with idle stumbling. I want to show you this. I said on one of those videos that there was only two vacuum takeoffs on the 4.2 manifold, and that's not true. So I was playing around with, I don't know why I never noticed this one. So this one here operates the all of the, how would you say it, the controls for the air flaps in the cabin. And I was, you know, playing around with it, and I put the vacuum gauge, I got another video up where I put a vacuum gauge on this one, and I showed that it was leaking enough that I had to go through and rebuild this brake system. Put a vacuum gauge on this, and also these little fuel transfer pipes for the rich start were a bit loose. I don't know how bad that would have been. I've got no way to test that because it's all inside of the block here. But I put the vacuum gauge on this takeoff, and sure enough, it was leaking like a sieve. And I, because I don't use any of those vacuum controls anyway, and it's probably the problem's much further downstream, I just blanked it off. And I'll tell you what, the idle is spot on. I'm hoping that once we put this back together, it'll be good enough that I can go for a drive and show you that. So I guess the next step will be put the power steering pump back together, pray it doesn't leak, fill it up. I'll have to cut another gasket for the block side there. I actually did that with my intake manifold gaskets there the other day at work. It's not hard. These things work perfectly now. So I guess I'll put a gasket together, go down to Supercheap, buy some goop, put it together again, and I don't know, cross our fingers, see what happens. Feeling pretty good about it, actually. I think that that's what will have done it. I'm tossing up whether the oil filter is brand new. That's got 500 Ks on it. I thought, oh, look, maybe... I replaced this in Sydney, actually. I thought, oh, maybe, maybe it's a blockage in the oil filter. It turns out not. I'm thinking what I might do is actually cut this apart. If this is 500 kilometers old, then this is going to tell us how much, if any, metal has been lost from the engine from running in such low oil pressure. Just tipping it up on its end. I know all about engine glitter because I've owned a lot of very high-powered motorcycles. It wasn't that bad, but I could tell that there was very, very fine, small, tiny amounts of metal fragments come out of this. We'll see if I can pick it up on camera. Maybe there's a chance it's all just in my head as well. But I guess we'll see. So what I'll do for the afternoon, might go make a cup of tea. What I'll do for the afternoon is get that gasket. Might go down to Supercheap and get some gasket goo. I've run out of RTV. They reckon that you probably will need to see if I can get some light on that. Actually, right here. So, see these two chambers in the oil filter mount, I suppose. You need to be really careful that this part here is sealed properly because you've got high and low pressure areas here. And that is, balancing this is the job of this oil circuit balancer, I guess you'd call it. And if you are leaking across this bridge here, then you're in trouble. So you're doing something that this should be doing for you. So you do need to be careful that this is properly sealed up, and especially so in here, because if it is leaking, it will show as dodgy oil pressure again. So I guess I'll sort that out, try and put it back together as much as I can, and we'll start it up and see what happens. So I'll see you guys soon. All right, back with tea. I just want to try and show you this. So I hadn't cleaned this off, and I just ran this under a bit of alcohol. And if you can see there, get the camera to focus. So see how we're certainly wearing a lot more on one side of that relief valve. And that's because the piece of plastic was caught on this side. So I'm pretty confident that this is going to be the problem. The bigger question is, it just looks like it's taken the finish off. Where are we? If I look at this from the side, it looks fine. I'm a little nervous by what I've read online that this is going to need to be faced in a lathe. The easy thing to do or to try would be to chuck this in a drill and then very, very gently run around that with a little bit of fine wet and dry and see what happens. I'll try that first, I think. I don't know. Look, I want to get this done before I put it back together. I'll finish my tea and make a decision, I think. See you soon. All right, so I think it's worth doing something. Now, sadly, I don't have a metal lathe. I'd love one. Please fund me for one. But no, I don't. I've got a drill here. I'll just put that in the chuck, and what I'll do with some very, very gentle sandpaper, I might even start with some dish scrubbers. This is just brass, this little piece, so that'll be fine. Plug this in, poor man's lathe. Try and face away this little ridge down in here. Because if I do put it back together, what I realize, if I do put it back together and this is leaking even a quarter of what it was before, then it's gonna put it in my head that the rest of the motor's fucked. So this needs to be proper, done well. So done well, has it in a drill. see how I go, and I'll talk soon. All right, I'll just try and show you what I'm doing to try and face up this valve. So I have a little very fine hobby file here, and what I'm doing is just ever so slightly pressing it inside of that lip there, so I don't damage the little I don't know what these are for here, probably to direct the oil around it, but it's a little bit dirty at the moment, but that's actually coming up really well. I'm actually really happy with that. So we've nearly faced out. So there's still a little bit more to go over here. So it was a little bit on the piss, and hopefully we'll be able to clean it up enough that it will function well. So unfortunately I can't set my camera up anyway. Obviously this is what you do if you don't have a metal lathe. Put this in a metal lathe, people. Get someone you know to do this for you. yeah, all right, see you soon. All right, I'll try and show you what we've ended up with, if we can get a focus. So I only took just enough, so it wasn't perfectly flat. So, well, now it is. Now it is. But that was just using a drill and a file. Please do as I say and not as I do. Do this on a metal lathe. But just goes to show it can be done simply. So we'll chuck it back together now and see what happens. So the other concern is the condition of the seat that the valve rests on. But luckily enough, Jaguar are smart enough to put a hardened steel insert in there. So the only thing that's really going to fuck out is a little valve that we just faced off. So I'm not concerned about that at all. I'll give it a bit of a tidy up and get any remaining crap out of there. But pretty happy with how this is going. All right, so we've cleaned everything up and we're going to reassemble just as we see here. So keep your Bible handy in times like this, because if you put this around the wrong way or something, you're in a lot of trouble by the time you realize what you've done. Be another 10 hours in the shop. So just like this, very clean inside, very clean here. There's one more little piece that sits on the end of that, a little spider, as Jaguar would call it. I suppose, I mean, just looking at this, right? I mean, the spring rate would determine how much oil pressure you get. I see on Rob Beer's website that he has adjustable oil pressure valves, and I suppose with a higher spring rate, you get a higher pressure. I don't know why you'd only be looking for 40 PSI. I can't see any good reason why you couldn't run 100 PSI through it. Originally, they had paper filters, and I guess that they were worried that they'd blow the paper filters apart, but you know, this thing's a big whack of metal now, so I don't know, something to think about. Let me know what you think. All right, guys, I just want to show you something. Just be really careful of this. It's hard to get a picture on. I was just cleaning up some of this old silicon gasket gunk here, and that dropped into one of the passageways. If you were to let that go through, look, 9 times out of 10, it's just going to get chewed up and eaten. But there is a chance that that could block up an oil passage, and you'd never know it because you know it branches out into however many passages after here. So be very careful of this. I guess I'll try and get a jeweler's screwdriver into there. You can see it's about to fall off the little edge. Pray for me, friends. All right, I just dragged out the vacuum, and that sorted it out. All right, so it's now the next day. I finished up about 11 o'clock last night. Put everything back together. I haven't started it yet, so put the mechanical gauge back on. Pretty confident everything's where it should be. The only thing is, I haven't started it yet. The only thing is I adjusted the idle last time I had it running, so it may not jump straight up. So I guess we'll do it live together, friends. My biggest concern is the power steering pump. It's probably going to leak all over the fucking floor. Maybe not. Who knows? It's running low on PS fluid, so I'll have to go and pick some of that up. So, yeah, stay with me. All right, that's a lesson in double checking and triple checking. So I must have knocked the little spring steel tab off that when I was screwing around over there. Didn't see it. And see that little graphite pin in there? That's broken off from one side jumped off, and then I stupidly tried to grab it, hold it back on, and it snapped it off. I have another one, luckily. Just threw that back in. Let's try again and see what happens. Right, got it back together. That was a little embarrassing, but sounding really good for him. So we're cold, about 50 psi. I'll leave it idling here until I can take it off the AED, then I'll go park it around the corner and see what it looks like. Alright guys, aside from the horrific noise the power steering pump's making because it's running low in fluid, I suspect it's just pumping air. We're actually getting better oil pressure than what we did before. So it's idling now and it's about 38 psi. And then when you, see if I can set this up, when you rev it, the moment you rev it, it comes up to about 45, and I suspect that that's where the relief valve is set to open. So the moment you do it, it goes up to, actually probably more like 50 actually. You get 50 and no more. But idling at 40, that's not half bad, mate. So it must have had something caught in it previously, or maybe that facing off of the valve we did has helped it. But I was expecting I'd actually lose pressure from wear, from having driven it for so long without oil pressure. So I'll go home, put the original sender back in, and then I'm off to Super Cheap to get some fluid for the pump. Let's see if I can catch that noise on camera. It's not nice. All right, let's do it. All right, guys, so I put the original sender back in, and you can see here just idling away. We're at about 30 psi. If I sit here for long enough, it'll come back to about 28, 25, something like that. But this is better than what we had before, so I'm really happy with this. This sender here, I now know reads low because on our mechanical gauge down there, I know that bypass valve, or the relief valve, sorry, is cutting off at about 48 to 50 psi. So cruising around town, I mean, the moment the revs pick up, shoots straight up to about 42, 43 on the gauge here. Really happy with that. We've gotten somewhere and fixed the problem. So yeah. All right, I'm gonna call this section opinions that no one asked for, but they're gonna get anyway. So I've owned this car for the last 6 months, maybe a little bit more. And in that time, I've probably put 7,000-8,000 Ks on it. And I don't baby it at all. I drive this car as much as the fuel price allows me to. I just got back from 2,500 Ks in New South Wales just for a bit of a road trip. And I guess I've formed a couple of opinions about this car in that time. I've never really owned cars for the sake of, owning a nice car before. I've had cars in the past, but I'm a bike guy. I've had maybe 15, 16, 17 bikes in the time I've had three cars. And they've always just kind of been a means to, get around, I guess. And this, I guess I think of this thing in the same way. I still use it to drive around. But it's the first car that I've ever thought, wow, this is a really special thing to own. And I guess the content of this video is proof in a way of why that is, because I'm not a mechanic. I have a technical background, yeah. But, I'm a bit of a hack. I guess you'd call myself me a hack, like I can rebuild bike engines, but this is the first car that I've ever really tackled before. And I guess the biggest difference is that, everything's just bigger and heavier and in a way easier to work on. So, it gets me thinking. I was reading the other day about minis, the new minis that they're releasing, and planned obsolescence as designed into the car. So the new minis have a plastic water pump that is not, well, I mean, they don't say it, but it will fail at 120,000 kilometers, which is just when your warranty will end, and that just, I don't know, it gets to me. The Jaguar guys watching this video, they know, as well as I do, that the water pump in this thing is heavy enough that it would kill someone if you threw it at them. It's a big whack of cast iron, and I hate to say, I hate to sound like, you know, a boomer here, but they just don't make them like they used to, mate. And that's true. They don't make them like they used to, and that makes this car so special. You know, anyone, myself included, can spend an afternoon and fix problems that would otherwise be, you know, mechanic time and thousands of dollars to fix, you know, with just an afternoon and a few, you know, basic tools, you can pull one of these things to pieces and very easily diagnose problems and fix those problems, you know. And that's, I mean, this is you know, a bit older than an XJ6, but that's true from every Jaguar made from, I mean, I don't have any experience with pre-48, but the motor's the same from 1948 to 1996. You know, they're a very well-built car, you know, and I don't say that because I own one. Like, you know, they really are. They're well-built cars. They're good cars to own. And I do suggest to people all the time, don't have to buy a 420, but, you know, old XJ6s, you can get them for bugger all money. And it's just the same running gear as what this one has here. So, you know, good cars. I enjoy it. I have loved owning this thing for every day that I've owned it. So, you know, and the only problems that I've had in that time are age related, and it's hard to be mad at it for that. You know, it's a 60-year-old car. At the end of the day, no matter how well you build something, it's gonna have issues after 60 years. Even that little piece of plastic that we pulled out of the relief valve, you know, I have no doubt that wouldn't happen in a new Jaguar. You know, I get the feeling that, you know, Jaguar make good cars. I don't know anything about modern Jaguars, but, you know, in the day, Jaguar made good cars because they knew that in making a good car, they'd sell themselves, you know. And that's not a thing that you see very often these days. I was just watching a documentary about Boeing and how they lost their way in the late 90s, you know, because before they'd say, well, we make safe planes and good planes and they sell themselves. And then, you know, eventually the old capitalism and planned obsolescence and just money for the sake of money just takes over and kills everything. So, you know, it's a sad thing in a way because these cars won't be around forever. And I think, nice Mustang, I think, you know, the cars that they build today, they won't be around in 60 years. And if in 30 years, they won't be looking at them in the same way that we look at these cars now, you know. And maybe that's why people are buying old cars a little bit more. I don't know. They seem to be going up in value. So tell me what you think. See you guys next video.